types of slabs, like one way, two way, and if we have designed the various types of slabs. Now the last unit will be dealing with the design of columns. In this slide, in this presentation, we will discuss types of columns, axially loaded column and uniaxially loaded column. Now, column. We will see the introduction for columns. It is also known as compression member in general, and in it is also called as strut in case of roof truss. Roof truss is a steel member which is used in industries, and it supports the roofing sheets. In a roof truss, some members may carry tension and some members may carry compression. The members which carries compression are called strut. As per codal provisions, it is defined as a structural member which transfers load from slabs and beams to the ground in the form of compression. Now, according to codal provision, as per IS 456/2000, it is defined as a compression member whose effective length exceeds 3 times the least lateral dimension. Suppose if B is the width of the column and D is the depth of the column, and the width B is called least lateral dimension. It carries live load from the floor, dead load of the beam and floor slabs, and its own weight. And this is the strut. In case of a steel structure, there is a I section column connected with the beam and the inclined member which is supporting the beam with the column is called strut. And the column may not be always vertical, it can also be in inclined position. Here, this is the typical picture of a roof truss. Here you can find the strut member which is inclined and it carries compression. This is the strut member. It always carries compression in its axial direction. Now, in case of a RASi framed structure, this is the, in this picture, you can find all the structural components of an RASi structure, that is floor slab supported by primary beam, that is across the width of the structure, and along the longitudinal direction, the secondary beams are provided to support the primary beams. And these beams transfer the floor load to the columns. Here, the columns are classified into 3 based on its position. The edge columns, that is provided along the walls of the, along the 4 sides of the structure, is called edge columns. And the column provided in the corners are called corner columns. And the slabs provided in between the structure, that is in between the sides, are called interior columns. And the column is provided with foundation at below the ground level to transfer the load safely to the ground. This is the typical reinforcement cage provided in the beam and column joints, beam and column framed structure. This is the picture before pouring the concrete into the formwork, and these reinforcements are checked before the construction happens at the site. That is, before concreting, we have to ensure whether all the reinforcements are provided as per the drawing. That is, whether they have provided the right number of rods in the column and the spacing between the lateral ties and the diameter of column and diameter of stirrup. Everything should be checked before placing the concrete into the formwork. This is the construction stage of framed structure having only beams and columns. Later on, the slabs will be casted. And this is the connection between the column and the foundation. Here, the corner bars provided in the column are bent in the diagonal direction in 4 different directions to have proper anchorage with the foundation. And it could be extended up to 300 mm. We will see what is pedestal. Pedestal is some vertical compression member whose effective length is less than 3 times the least lateral dimension. In previous slide, we have discussed the column is a member which has effective length more than 3 times the least lateral dimension. Suppose if the effective length is less than the 3 times its width, then that member is called to be as pedestal, that is having very small height compared to column. Now, before getting into design of column, we have to discuss some new design parameters as per the caudal provisions. Number one, slenderness ratio. Number two, cross-sectional dimensions. Number three, effective length. Number four, support conditions. We will see the slenderness ratio, what it is. And if you see the IS code book 456 under class 25.3, which is in page number 42, the screenshot of that part is provided in the right hand side of your slide. There you can see the unsupported length between end restraints shall not exceed 60 times the least lateral dimension of your column. If in any given plane, one end of the column having unrestrained, its unsupported length L shall not exceed 100 into B square by D. B is the width of the column, D is the depth of the column. L is the actual height of the column. Now let us see. Slenderness ratio of a column is measured by dividing the unsupported length or clear height of the column, say L, by least lateral dimension of the column, that is your width. The value of this L by B is less than or equal to 60 for any column. In case of column that is not restrained at one end, that is it is free at one end and fixed at other end, then the L, the actual height of the column, can be less than or equal to 100 B square by D. And this the condition should be followed when the column is fixed at one end or pinned at one end and free at the other end. Here we will discuss the classification of column based on the type of reinforcements. Here the vertical bars are called longitudinal bars, are the main bars which is going to carry the compression within its structure. Then the ties are called the secondary reinforcement or transverse reinforcements provided at certain spacing to hold the main reinforcement as well as to protect the column away from buckling. We will see buckling, what it is buckling, which arises in upcoming slides. This is the tied column having its cross section. Main bars are provided at each corner with a clear cover. And all the lateral ties are folded and bent inside at 45 degree at one corner to have a proper anchorage. While applying the load, the lateral ties should not open up. Now we will see the second type of column, that is spiral column. Here the lateral ties are provided wound like a spring, that is a continuous lateral tie is provided in the form of spiral or helical, and it is provided from uniformly from top end to the bottom end of the circular column. Here the minimum number of bars in a circular column is 6, and the minimum number of bars in a square or rectangular column is 4 as per caudal provision. And this is a composite column. Here this I section is a steel column, and which is provided inside the core of the reinforced rectangular column. And when we use two different types of material like reinforced concrete and structural concrete, then the column is said to be a composite column. Now we will see what are tied column, spiral column and composite column. Tied column is the column in which the main longitudinal bars are confined within closely spaced lateral ties. In case of beam, we will call these ties as stirrups, and in case of column, we will call these ties as lateral ties are loops. Now, second type is your spiral column, in which the main longitudinal bars are enclosed within closely spaced and continuously wound spiral reinforcement. Now, the third type is composite column, in which the structural sections like I section, channel section, pipes are embedded as a longitudinal reinforcement within the reinforced cement concrete column. Next, we will see the classification of column based on reinforcements, based on shape. Number one, square column. Number B, rectangular column. Number C, rectangular circular column. Number D, T section column. Number E, L section column. In our reinforced concrete buildings, predominantly we will use the first three types: square column, rectangular column, and circular column. Now, the other classification is based on loading, that is number A, axially loaded column, number B, uniaxially, number B, uniaxially, eccentrically loaded column, number C, biaxial eccentrically loaded column. In your syllabus, we have designed only on axially loaded column and uniaxially eccentrically loaded column. You will see what it is. Under axially loaded column, it supports four beams of equal spans. When your column is provided with beams on its four sides of equal length, then the load from each column, each beam will be equal, and the column will not have any lateral bending. Then the such type of axially loaded column is found in interior spaces of the structure. Hence, it is an interior column rarely provided in multi-story buildings symmetrically loaded from all four sides. It does not buckle in any direction. That is, whatever the load is provided, applied on the column, it will completely transfer through its axis. Now, you will see second type, uniaxial eccentrically loaded column. It supports beams on two opposite sides only. Other two sides, the beams will not be provided. It buckles in only one direction, because in two direction beams will be transferring the load, other two direction there will not be any load. So this imbalance causes this buckling in about in one direction. Now, third type is biaxially eccentrically loaded column. It is a column which supports beams on any two mutual perpendicular directions, that is any two adjacent sides. Example, corner column. The corner column will be supporting the beam in both x direction and y direction, and it buckles in two directions, that is x and y direction. This is the axial column. See, the load is transferring through its center, at centroid axis of the column. In second case, the load is having some eccentricity EX in the X direction from its origin. Now, this column is called uniaxially bending column. The third type is the load is placed in any one quarter of the column, and it will be having two eccentricity, that is EX and EY. Eccentricity is the distance between the load and the origin of the column, that is centroidal axis and the actual point of application of the load. It is measured in two direction, that is in X direction as well as in Y direction. That is why this column will be bending in both X direction as well as in Y direction. Now, in this slide, we will learn how to identify the axial column from a given plan. For example, if you consider this B2, this column is supporting the beam on four sides, and here all the span of four beams are equal, and hence it will not undergo any buckling in any direction. That is why this B2 column is said to be a balanced column. Since its moments are cancelled in both x direction, y direction, and x direction, hence this B2 will be transferring the load in its axis, and it is called axial column. Here we will identify the uniaxial columns. All the columns provided on the four sides other than the corners are called uniaxial column. Here the column is supporting the beam in only one side of the x axis, and it carries beams on both sides, both directions of y, that is plus y and minus y. Here the beam is provided on only in minus x direction. The beam is not provided on the positive x direction. Hence the moments in the y direction are balanced, and the moments coming from the beam is not balanced. Hence this D2 will be buckling away from its position in the x direction. Then that is why this column is called uniaxially loaded column. Next, C3 is not having the beam on the y direction, that is positive y direction, whereas it is having beams on both minus and negative, minus and positive x direction, and it is having beam in the negative y direction. And B3 is also the same case. A2, B1, C1 are all coming under this particular category, uniaxial eccentrically loaded column. Now the leftover corner columns, it is supporting beam in x direction and another beam in the y direction, and hence this column will be buckling simultaneously in both x direction away from its position, and it will also buckle away from its position in the y direction. Hence these corner columns are classified as biaxially eccentrically loaded columns. Now we will see orientation of column, that is how the width of the column should be aligned, how the depth of the column should be aligned. Now we know, we have already discussed that width of the column is its least lateral dimension, whereas the depth is called larger lateral dimension. As the span of beam increases, the column has to carry more load and buckles away more at near the top. Hence the depth of the column is oriented along the longer spans of the beam, and the width is oriented along the shorter spans of the beam for economical design. When the column is supporting beams of equal span in both x and y direction, then square column is preferred to rectangular column. Why? Because the moment from x direction and y direction will be equal, and the beam should, the column should have equal dimension in both x and y direction. That is why we prefer square column. Now we will see the typical planar floor plan of your building. Here this is the largest span of the beam, and this is the shortest span of the beam compared to these two beams. Here the depth of the column is aligned with the longest span, and the width of the column is aligned with the shortest span. Now here the beam is, here the column is oriented along the longer span of the beam, and it is right manner. If you see the third column, it is oriented along the, it is oriented perpendicular to the longer span beams, and it is wrong manner, and it should be turned like this. Since there is no beam provided in this direction, or the beam may be shorter in span compared to this y direction beam. And if you provide the column like this, it should be projecting inside the floor plan, and it will be causing some hindrance for occupying the floor space. That is why we will always orient the column within the walls. Now the fourth classification is based on the slenderness ratio. The slenderness ratio is the ratio between effective length and least lateral dimension, B or T. A rectangular column is classified into two types. One is short column and other one is slender or long column. If the slenderness ratio, that is L by B, is less than 12, then it is classified as short column. And if the ratio is more than 12 or equal to 12, then it is called long column or slender column. Now we will see what is this effective length. Effective length of the column is defined as the length between the points of contraflexure of the buckled column. You know that point of contraflexure is the point near the top end of the column and the other point will be near the bottom end of the column. At that point where the bending moment changes its nature from positive to negative, that is, at these points of contraflexure, the moment will be zero and the length measured from one point of contraflexure near the bottom to the other point near the top is called effective length. Effective length is calculated for both major x-axis and minor y-axis of the column. It is calculated as LEX for a major axis and LEY for minor axis. And it is given as a formula in the code book, K into LX and K into LY. LX is the actual height of the column measured in X direction and LY is the actual height of the column measured in Y direction. In most of the cases, these two, the value of LX will be equal to LY. And K is the effective length constant based on the support conditions taken from code book IS 456, table number 28, and it is given in page number 94. This is the screenshot of the table number 28 given in IS 456. We will see the first column, that is degree of rain restraint of compression support. Nothing but the support conditions. First one is both ends are fixed, that is effectively held in position and restrained against rotation in both ends. And second one is effectively held in position at both ends, restrained against rotation at one end. See, the picture is given for each and every type of the column. The second, this is also known as one end is fixed and other end is pinned. The third type is, it is effectively held in position in both ends but not restrained against rotation. That is, it will not, the column will not move from its position but it will rotate. It can have some slope at both ends. This type of column is called columns with both ends pinned. Next one, one end is fixed, the other end is guided roller. Here, the column is not allowed to rotate or move from its position in the bottom end, but in the case of top end, it is allowed to move in one direction, but it should not have any slope. If you see the column near the end, top end, it will be having straight, it will not be having any slope. Clear? That is why it is explained as effectively held in position and is restrained against rotation at one end and at the other end restrained against rotation but not held in position. Next, number 5, effectively held in position and restrained against rotation in one end, that is it is fixed at bottom and at the other end partially restrained against rotation but not held in position. That is, it can have rotation as well as rotation for some limited quantity and it can move from its position. That is, one end is fixed, other end is called roller. Next, sixth type is effectively held in position at one end but not restrained against rotation. That is, at the bottom, the column is pinned and at the other top end restrained against rotation but not held in position. That is, it is a guided roller. It can be able to move from its position but cannot have any slope near the top end. And effectively held in position and restrained against rotation at one end, that is fixed but not held in position nor restrained against rotation at the other end, meaning one end is fixed and the top end is free. Now we will see the value of effective length for all these seven types of compression members. That is number one. If both ends are fixed, this is the strongest column and it will be having the lowest value of effective length, that is 0.5L. It is theoretically calculated and the recommended value of effective length is 0.65. In our design, for economical design, this value is revised to 0.65L. And we will ignore the theoretical value of effective length and we will consider only the recommended value of effective length in our design. The value, which is the value of effective length, is high in case of one end fixed and the other end free, that is seventh type, and the sixth type, one end pinned, the other end is roller. So these two are the weakest column. Once the effective length increases, the column may reduce its load carrying capacity. When the effective length decreases, the load carrying capacity of the column increases, and that is why this column with both ends fixed are the strongest one. The second strongest column is one end fixed, the other end is pinned. That is, the effective length is 0.8L. The third strongest column is the column with both ends pinned. That is, the effective length is taken as its actual height itself. That is 1 into L. Next, the fourth type. The effective length is slightly increased by 20% of its original height, that is 1.2L. And the fifth strongest column is 1.5L. That is one end is fixed, the other end is provided with roller. Now, sixth type is one end is pinned, the other end is guided roller. Guided roller means it is allowed to move, but it is not allowed to rotate. When roller means it is allowed to rotate as well as it is allowed to move from its position. Now weakest column is one end is roller and other end is pinned. And another weakest column is one end is fixed and the other end is free. All the lampposts you see in the roadways are coming under this category. That is, one end is fixed, the other end is free. And the effective length should be calculated as 2 times its original height. Next, we will see what is buckling. Buckling is a type of failure occurring in a column and it could be sudden and it could be without any warning also sometime. Buckling can be defined as a sudden large deformation. Deformation means the deflection of the column due to a slight increase of an existing load under which the structure had exhibited little deformation before the load was increased. See, this is the actual position of the column and this curve is called the buckled position of the column. So when the load is applied, it will be buckling in the minor axis or major axis, whichever the column is having weaker dimension. Suppose it is provided with least lateral dimension along the x direction, then it will be buckling in x direction. To control this, we will provide the column with its largest lateral dimension, that is the depth along the major axis x. So when the thickness of the column increases, the buckling will reduce. The second picture, you can see the steel buckled column and it is hollow and it is circular. And this is the reinforced concrete column which is having buckling in both x direction as well as in the y direction. Here the buckling is seen in only in one direction. You will see the one of the important design parameter is eccentricity. Minimum eccentricity should be followed as per IS 456 given in page number 42, that is class 25.4. On your right, you can see the screenshot of the IS 456 class 25.4 minimum eccentricity. See, what is explained here is provided on the left hand side of your slide. Eccentricity is the distance between center point of the column and the point of application of load. For rectangular or circular column, the minimum eccentricity is calculated based on two values. Out of these two values, the maximum value is taken as the minimum eccentricity of the circular or rectangular column. The one value, first value is 20 mm and second value is original height of the column divided by 500 plus the depth of the column divided by 30. If you are getting 25 mm from the second value and 20 mm is fixed as per IS 456, then the maximum of these two is 25 mm and that 25 mm is your minimum eccentricity. For example, sometimes you may get L by 500 plus D by 30 as 15, 18, less than 20. In that case, you have to consider only the maximum 20 mm as the minimum eccentricity of the circular or rectangular column. Square column is also said to be a rectangular column, so you need not worry about square column. Wherever rectangular column is provided, you can design it as a square column also. For non-rectangular column or non-circular column, that is the column having hexagonal cross section, pentagonal cross section, triangular cross section, then the minimum eccentricity is taken as maximum of 20 and L by 300. That is clear height of the column divided by 300. Suppose if you are getting 15, then 20 is your answer. Suppose if you are getting 25, then 25 will be the answer for minimum eccentricity. That is what explained in this class 25.4. Next, we will see about longitudinal reinforcement. Longitudinal reinforcements are the vertical bars provided in the column. They are the main bars will be transferring the load actually. The vertical bars are provided along the entire height of the column to carry the direction compression in axially loaded column. And it is will be helpful in resisting the bending moment in both uniaxial and biaxial columns. And the codal provision says the area of the cross-sectional area of longitudinal reinforcement bars would range between 0.8% to 6% of the gross area AG. And if you see the code book, page number 48, under class 26.5.3.1, this point is referred in point number A. Next important provision is minimum number of bars is 4 for rectangular column and 6 for circular column, and this is stated in point number C. Here I have removed point number B because we don't refer that B often in our design. Minimum diameter of the bar to be used is 12 mm and it is stated in point number D. And in helical columns, the minimum number of bars is minimum number of bars is 6 and that is provided in point number E. Next, we will see the lateral ties, that is other name for lateral ties is transverse reinforcement. Lateral ties is provided in the form of square or rectangular loops or helicals in the case of circular columns, provided at certain spacing throughout the entire height of the column, that is from the bottom to the top end of the column, to hold the longitudinal vertical bars in position, and it is used to protect the inner core of the concrete from splitting. The inner core of the concrete means the concrete apart from the clear cover. It is also provided to prevent the outward buckling of the column. So when the column is subject to some sort of buckling, these lateral ties will resist that buckling to some extent. It cannot control the buckling completely, but it can prevent and it can resist to some extent. Now you will see some geometrical dimensions to be followed in the design. That is pitch. Number one, pitch is the spacing between the ties. That is center to center distance between these rectangular loops or spirals. And it is taken as minimum value of 2 of three values. Minimum, it is taken minimum of these three values. Number one, least lateral dimension, that is width of the column small b, and 16 times of the diameter of main bar. Suppose if the lateral dimension of the column is 200 mm, then second case, 16 times the dimension of main bar. Suppose if your main bar is 10 mm, then 16 to 10 is 160 mm. And the third is, the value given is 300 mm. Now, which is minimum out of these three values? That is, if the least lateral dimension of the column is 200 mm, and 16 times the diameter of main bar, for example, 10 mm is the diameter of main bar, then it is 160, and third value is 300, as specified in point number C1, that is printed in page number 49, class C, class 26.5.32, here under point number C, the first point. The pitch of transverse reinforcement shall not be more than the least of the following distances, that is least lateral dimension, 16 times the smallest diameter of the bar, and 300 mm. So out of these three, we have to consider the lowest one. Here in our case, we got 116 to 10, 160 is the lowest, and the pitch of the tight bars will be 160 mm. Next, maximum spacing of helicals, that is the distance, center to center distance, provided between the helical tight bars, and it should be the lowest of two values, that is 75 mm and 1/6 of the core diameter of the column, that is provided in point number D. That is, you can see the lowest part of your slide, helical reinforcement is allowed, for which the pitch of helical turns shall not be more than 75 mm, nor more than 1/6 of the core diameter of the column. Core diameter is the diameter of the column excluding the clear covers. Next, here maximum is discussed. Now we will discuss the minimum spacing of helicals. That is the lowest value of two specifications. Number one is 25 mm. Number two is 3 times the diameter of helical bar. And it is also discussed in the same point number D. Now minimum diameter of bar for ties is maximum of 1/4 of the main bar and 6 mm. Suppose if you are using a 20 mm main bar, then 20 by 4 is 5 mm and the fixed value is 6 mm. So a maximum is 6 mm. So 6 mm should be the minimum diameter of bar. That means you can use 6 mm or 8 mm for the diameter of lateral ties. Now please note that this value is wrongly printed in your code book as 16 mm. Please change to 6 mm. That is point number C2. The diameter of the polygonal links or lateral ties shall not be less than the 1/4 of the diameter of largest longitudinal bar and in no case less than 16 mm. This 16 mm is amended in the another revision of this code book and they have specified us to use 6 mm instead of 16 mm. Now we will see the design procedure of axially loaded short columns. You know what is short column? Short column is the column whose slenderness ratio is less than 12. Now, first step is to calculate the axial load on the column. Now, axial load on the column is calculated as the equation 1, which is given in page number 71 under class 39.3. Pu equal to 0.4 FCK AC plus 0.67 FY into AAC. We will see all the parameters one by one. Pu is the axial load and FCK is the characteristic compressive strength of the concrete based on the grade and AC is the area of concrete provided in the column, cross-section area of concrete provided in the column excluding the area of steel plus 0.67 into Fy. Fy is the strength of the steel based on its three grades Fe250, Fe415 and Fe500 into AAC. What is AAC? AAC is given as area of longitudinal reinforcement for column, that is area of steel provided in the column. Now, for simplicity, we are going to alter this equation 1. And the altered equation is, what is AAC? AAC is the area of main reinforcement provided from 0.8% to 6% of cross area, that is total cross section area of the column. And we have seen that this is stated in point number D, point number A under class 26.5.3, which is given in page number 48. Now we will see how to calculate area of concrete. AC is equal to gross area minus steel area, area of steel. That is AC equal to AG minus AC. Now we are going to substitute this in equation 1 and we will be getting PU equal to 0.4 FCK AG plus 0.67 FY minus 0.4 FCK into AC. The above equation is applicable only if the minimum eccentricity of that particular column is less than or equal to 0.05 times the least lateral dimension. Now we will get into the design problem. Read this question. Yeah, rectangular reinforced concrete column of size 300 mm and 600 mm. 300 is your width of the column and 600 mm is the depth of the column. To support an ultimate axial load of 2000 kN. Ultimate axial load is nothing but factored axial load PU. Design suitable reinforcements in the column using M20 grade concrete and Fe415 HYSD bars. Now step 1, we will write all the given data, that is PU 2000, B300, D600, Fy415, FCK20. Step number 2, longitudinal reinforcement, and it is calculated from the altered formula given in page number 71. Now we will substitute all the given data, that is PU is known, 2000 into 10 power 3 Newton and 0.4, FCK is 20, AG is the gross area, that is width into depth of the column, plus 0.67 into FY is strength of the steel bar, 415, minus 0.4 into 20 into AAC. AAC is the area of reinforcement which we have to design. Now AAC is found to be 2073 mm square. Now we will assume 22 mm dia bars, number of bars is total area divided by one area of 22 mm dia bar, and it is rounded to greater value, greater even value, that is if you are getting 3.3 then it is rounded off to 4. Suppose if you are getting 5.5 then it is rounded off to 6. If you are getting 6.6 then you have to round off to 8, not 7. We should always follow even number, then only the bars can be provided in the column symmetrically about its both major and minor axes. So these 6 bars are provided, 3 each on 2 opposite shorter faces of the column. Now step number 3 is transverse reinforcement. Let's provide the rectangular ties. Why? Because the given column is a rectangular column, so we have to provide rectangular ties. Minimum diameter of bar is specified from IS code is maximum 1/4 of the main bar and 6 mm. So we will calculate 1/4 of the main bar. Main bar is 22 mm, so 22 divided by 4 is 5.5 and 6 is the fixed value from the code book, so maximum out of these two is 6. So minimum diameter of your transfer reinforcement should be 6 mm or greater than this 6 mm. So we are adopting 8 mm. Why? Because 6 mm bar is not available in the market nowadays. Pitch spacing, that is the center to spacing between the transverse loops or transverse lateral ties, and it is calculated as minimum of 3 values, that is least lateral dimension of the column, that is 300, that is width of the column. Next, 16 times the diameter of bar, so 16 to 22 is 352. Next, third value is fixed value, 300. So out of these 3, 2 are coming same value and 1 is 352, so which is minimum 300. So this 300 is the center to center spacing between these 8 mm dia lateral ties. So provide 8 mm dia rectangular ties at 300 mm center to center. Now take down the second problem as an assignment. Determine the axial load carrying capacity of the column of size 250 mm and 250 mm, that is it is a square column, so width and depth are equal, reinforced with 4 numbers of 12 mm dia bars, and use M20 grade concrete and Fe415 HYSD steel bars. Here you need to calculate only the value of PU. Just take down this formula specified in previous problem, you substitute all the values and get the value of PU, that's it. And this is such type of problem will be asked in part A, and this first problem will be asked in part B question. Thank you. If you are having any doubt, and it will be discussed in another session, exclusively given for clarifying your questions. Thank you.